And now it's a pleasure to announce Fabian with his, from CoreOS with his talk about Prometheus time series database.
I'm Fabian, I work at CoreOS. We are a company that does a bunch of stuff in open source, and we're building like Google-like infrastructure for enterprise. And I'm on the Prometheus team and developing the monitoring story there. And today I want to talk about alerting with time series. So it's not entirely about Prometheus. A lot of the stuff I'm going to talk about applies to alerting in general and alerting with time series with any system. But all the examples are in Prometheus. So who has not heard of Prometheus before? OK, who has tried it out? OK. So if you have any questions in between, just raise your hand and we'll explain so we don't lose anyone in between. So first of all, what's a time series? A time series is just a stream of values associated with one timestamp for each value. And this stream of data is then coupled with some identifier that tells you what this actually is about. And in Prometheus, the data model is that each time series is identified by a metric, which is in this case here, HTTP request total. And then you have these labels, and these are dimensions to this metric. And then you have certain values, and each unique combination of values for the set of labels for a metric is a single time series. So if I change the status here to 500, that's a new time series. And so each unique combination here, we can easily see that this blows up quite quickly, and we end up with hundreds of thousands of time series if we have about 100 instances here and have about 10 different request passes and have all the possible status codes. So in general, time series systems are huge, and this means that you need some sort of way to query it, because you have possibly millions of these. So you have to be able to filter them, to retrieve them, to transform them, so to change the value in some way, and to aggregate them so you can get a comprehensible set of time series from a larger set. So in this case here, HTTP request total, job equals nginx. This simply selects all the time series that have this name and this particular label with the nginx value. And the rate function now takes this counter time series and transforms it into a per second value based on the last 5 minutes. And this doesn't reduce the set of time series we have. And for that, we have to aggregate now. So we sum by pairs, which means we preserve the past label and aggregate all the other ones away into a single set. And the example is actually wrong. This is aggregated by status and pass. But you can see how this takes thousands of time series and gives you a comprehensible set. So a quick recap of how Prometheus works. Prometheus is a single binary, which you deploy. And this is one server, which handles retrieval of data, storing data, and then making it available for querying. And we do this by talking to a variety of service discovery integrations. So no matter whether you're using Kubernetes, AWS, EC2, Azure, are doing your own thing with Consul, or have any totally custom system, you can integrate with Prometheus. And Prometheus will then go out and ask your service discovery system, what is there out there to be monitored in the first place? And based on that, it then goes to all these targets, as we call them, and scrapes them for metrics. And there's just a simple format, how targets can expose time series and the most recent value they have. And then we have a query language, and you can just use an HTTP API or Grafana to then query this data again from Prometheus. And we built Prometheus with some design goals in mind, and these are mainly focused on what do we want from a time series database and monitoring system. But today we want to focus on how can we translate all these requirements to alerting. And we are coming from a point where we have a large infrastructure, like thousands of bare metal servers, and a lot of applications running there and a lot of user traffic. So we just have a bunch of stuff to monitor in the first place. And the monitoring system must be able to handle this. And one requirement is, if you don't change your infrastructure, the number of the traffic of your monitoring system should not increase either. And that means if you get DDoSed by an external source and you're generating your metric data as events, you're now amplifying the DDoS attack internally and are essentially DDoSing yourself. And with a time series-based system, that just doesn't happen because the metrics your systems expose are constant. So no matter how much external traffic you get, this will just change the values of your time series, but not the total traffic of your monitoring system. And this goes for alerting as well, right? If we define alerts based on time series, there's an upper bound on how many results there can be. So even if you have an external attack, the number of alerts does not go above a certain threshold. And then with modern infrastructure, you're doing this whole microservice thing, right? You have your monolithic applications and you break them up into microservices and scale them horizontally. And now we just have a lot more stuff to monitor in the first place. And the number of metrics these things have doesn't really change. So no matter whether you're running one large instance or a small one, they have the same metrics. So now we just have more metrics and from more targets. And these targets constantly change. At least we now have systems like Kubernetes or Mesos that allow you to be really dynamic about what is running where, and you don't even control this anymore yourself. And Prometheus keeps up with that by talking directly to the systems and being always in sync with the state of the world. And the alerting is not really affected by that if you alert based on this collected time series, because your alerting system doesn't even know about targets, it just knows time series data. So this is sort of abstracted away by having a monitoring system being capable to handle all these targets and their change. And then you want this fleet-wide overview, because now you have a microservice and inspecting a second instance doesn't really give you anything, right? You're building microservices because you want to be resilient to failure of single instances, and you want to basically distribute the load across all of these. So determining whether your service is healthy is not it's not given by a single instance anymore. So you want to know things like what's the 99th percentile of requests across all these instances and not just a single one. But if there's a problem, you still have to be able to drill down and investigate where the problem actually lies. And that gets even more important as your system gets more complex. There are more dimensions where failure can be. And if you just have an aggregated view, you can't really, you are losing information where this is actually coming from. So collecting all these raw and highly dimensional time series and storing them this way gives us really the ability to at query time then investigate and ask the questions we need to. And then ideally, we want to monitor all levels of our stack with the same system. That's kind of an obvious advantage. You have to operate one system and not five. All your users in your company can just interact with the same system, just have to learn one system, and you can easily correlate data across your stack. So you can easily infer whether a router failing is actually the cause for your service level failure. And we want the same for alerting, of course, right? If we have one system to monitor everything, we want the one system to alert with everything. And if our time series are in one system, that then easily translates into time series-based alerting. So we're going to take all of this. We have our nice monitoring system, which can be Prometheus or anything else, that provides you with all this raw data in form of time series, and how we want to do alerting. And with a lot of data, the intuition is usually that we want some sort of anomaly detection, machine learning, and having alerts automatically correlated, and then have everything be self-healing, and we're all happy. Just that it doesn't work anymore, the more data you have. It might work if you have 10 metrics or 100 time series, but if you have actually huge amounts of data, there's always something correlating, right? Systems are complex, systems are noisy, there's always some graph shooting up and down, and doesn't always imply that there's something wrong or right. So you'll necessarily get a ton of false positives. And that's not really an option, because you can't page people based on vague guesses whether something might be wrong, because they will burn out, right? If they get paged 10 times during the night, and 9 times it's not a problem, that's not really feasible and scalable. So you can, of course, tune your machine learning system and make it eliminate more false positives, but then necessarily you will end up also having some false negatives. And that's totally unacceptable, because if your data center is burning down and your machine learning system thinks that's maybe not too urgent right now, that's not an option. Like there can be no false negatives in our entire loading infrastructure. So with Prometheus, in general, with time series-based alerting, we want to take a different approach. And that is the idea that our time series reflect the state of the world, right? It's ideally collecting data from everywhere about anything, so it's a good representation of what's actually happening. And ideally, we should be able to define what state do we want our infrastructure to be in. And if you can't do that, then you probably have more urgent problems. So if you have the current state and know what the state should look like, we can just take the difference, and the delta is actually what is wrong in our system. Our systems are complex and huge, so how do we easily define what the desired state is, right? We can't validate for every single time series what value it should be at or in which value range. And that's where we come to symptom-based paging. Pages are alerts that actually wake someone up, that should always be urgent, so that they cannot wait until tomorrow, and should be actionable. So we should actually be able to do something about them. If you cannot do anything, there's no point in waking someone up, because they will just sit there and stare at the screen and be awake for nothing. And symptom-based pages have a huge advantage. First of all, every symptom, so something that indicates that your system is not providing the service it should, can have thousands of different causes, right? It's way easier to catch a symptom, for example, a high latency, than to try to figure out what all the possible causes should be and alert on these. So you really want to only alert with pages on the boundary between your system and your user. And the user might be your actual customer, but it might also be some other team internally that's using your service you're providing to other teams in your company. So if you just alert on this boundary, you're actually doing everything right, because you're designing your system to be resilient, right? You know that failure is expected, and you design a system to handle some sort of failure, for example, if a downstream dependency fails. If a dependency fails and you're still providing good service, well, then there's no reason to wake someone up, right? Because the system is actually handling a condition that it was designed to handle. And actually, it's quite easy to just capture all these symptoms, because there are not too many. There are these four golden signals, and one of them is latency. So if you're providing some sort of service, you get requests, and you respond. And there's certainly a time range in which you would like to respond. And if you go above that, you're just too slow, and your users are having a bad experience. So latency is one thing you want to alert on. The second thing is traffic. If your system is expected to handle 2,000 requests per second and you're currently receiving zero, that's probably wrong. So pretty trivial thing, right? Just check how many requests you're receiving and determine whether they are within the expected range. And closely related are errors. And errors are just failing requests, so they are a subset of your total requests. And if a user sees 1% errors, that's probably okay. If it's 50%, probably not. So you can also easily define a threshold of how many of your requests can be answered with an error. And the fourth golden signal is something a bit different, so we have to take a step back and look at cause-based warnings. We don't want to page on failures within your system or independencies of your system, because they might not be affecting your user. But it's certainly still valuable to catch some of these, right? And have them at least flashing on a dashboard so that someone who gets paged for an actual problem can see what the potential causes are and then investigate based on that. So it's certainly helpful. And saturation and capacity is this fourth golden signal, and it's arguably also more of a cause than an actual symptom. But you really want to catch these early. So imagine your disk is running out. You really don't want to wait until this impacts you, because it takes usually quite a long time to fix and has usually fatal consequences, like data corruption, etc. So saturation capacity is sort of this fourth golden signal that is not a symptom, but that you also want to always catch. And if you cover these four aspects, you're usually pretty good. So let's see how we can do this actually in the Prometheus model. So here we have a metric called etcd has leader, And etcd is a distributed key value store, which is based on the Graph protocol, which requires you to always have a leader or master that you can talk to. Otherwise, you can't do anything. And it's quite simple. We have here two labels, job, which just says this is etcd, and instance, which just determines which node we are talking about. And we just map whether it has leader to 0 and 1, so true and false. And 0 obviously is not good, and 1 is OK. And the Prometheus alerts look like this. You have this DSL, and it starts with the alert clause, in which you just specify a name for this alert. And then you enter in the if clause any Prometheus expression, which returns a vector of results. So for a set of time series, it returns the most recent value. And the default duration lets you basically handle flapping alerts. So if you have a really quick latency spike, that's probably not a problem if it resolves itself. So you don't need to page someone. So this default duration just captures only actually send me the alert if the condition has been true for 5 minutes or more. And labels are just additionally key value pairs you can assign to the alerts that are generated from this alerting rule. And annotations are quite similar, but they're not identifying. And these are just key value pairs where you can store useful stuff like descriptions of the actual alert or backlinks to a runbook that helps you handle the outage the alert indicates. Yeah, and the query expression in Prometheus, they return a vector, right? And we get an element and a certain value for it, and each entry in this vector is one single alert. So every alerting rule can generate something between zero and thousands of alerts if you want. I think I missed out the slides, yeah. Yeah, that's what we want. So this is an example alert, a really simple one. We want to alert if etcd has no leader. And we take the metric we've seen before and filter it by the value zero. So all elements, all time series, where the most recent value is not zero are dropped. And we only get the ones back that actually are zero. In our case here, the one for instance A and instance B. And then we say, OK, only alert me if this holds true for more than 1 minute, because the system might heal itself, which is OK and fine, and as intended. And then we add the severity label called page. And that's just our definition of how we define severity within our organization. This is not a fixed thing. And the final result of alerts will be these two lines here. And these are the label sets that specify what alert this is. That's all an alert is in Prometheus, plus the annotations that might provide descriptions, etc. And as we can see, we just take the alerts from our actual result and attach the alert name label and the label specified in the label section. Here's a second set of metrics. Here we have a request total metric, which is a counter for total requests received, and it's split out by dimensions of the service instance, the request pairs, and the request method. And you have a corresponding metric for request errors total, which indicates the same just for the failing requests. And now we want to build a simple symptom capturing page. So we want to capture if the error rate for our service is high. And we just take the request errors total metric, and we transform this counter into a per second value. So we get the current errors per second. And then we just get, for every single time series, one of these rate values. But that's not really helpful, because as I said before, you want to capture your service as a whole, right? You want to know, is my service healthy? And if it's a horizontally scaling application, looking at a single time series doesn't really give you anything. So we want to aggregate. And just use sum and just throw it all together, and we get out one value. And it has no labels anymore because we aggregated them all away. And then we can simply filter the result by greater than 500. So we actually only send an alert if there are more than 500 errors per second in our entire system. That seems to capture roughly what we want, but there's a problem. The threshold here is absolute, and that's not really good because it changes the actual semantics of your alerts with respect to your system. So if you look at your daily traffic curve, right, you have more users in the day than at night, you actually also have more errors because you have more total requests, which makes sense, right? So in total, you're still doing as good as before, but the threshold, our dashed line here, doesn't really capture it. So you're now alert during the day on something that's fine at night. And similar thing goes, if your traffic just increases over months, right? Your business is growing, you're getting more users, and you get more traffic, and now you always have to readjust this threshold. Similarly, if you have traffic spikes during the day because you, I don't know, got famous on Twitter, we somehow want to capture the errors with respect to our total traffic. And we can simply solve this by taking the same expression, just applying it to the request total metric instead of the request errors total metric. So we now just get a relative value to our request instead of the absolute one. And then we indicate, okay, we want to alert if this is greater than 1%. And what we then get is here as a threshold, this really smooth curve, which adapts to our total traffic and always represents the condition we want to. But it's still not good enough because we don't have any dimensions in this result, right? We just take everything about our service and throw it into one value and make a decision. But we're losing detail. Imagine you have your index page, which gets the most traffic, obviously, and you have a contact form. Nobody ever goes to your contact form, so it probably has like super low traffic, but what if it always returns an error every single time? We can't really see that. Which simply means we have some low traffic, high error passes, and some high traffic, low error passes, and aggregating it away will basically mask a signal we want to actually see. And we can fix that by introducing dimensionality into our aggregation, right? By telling our system, our monitoring system, give me all this you haven't given me before, but preserve these dimensions. So here we keep the instance and pass label. And what we then get is for every entry, we get one unique entry for every unique instance pass combination. So now we can see if our contact form, for example, has a really high error rate. Which seems good enough. We now capture a lot of stuff. But we are aggregating away the wrong dimensions. So that's something to be always aware of. Like, what dimension are we talking about? What dimensions am I fault tolerant along? And in this case of a horizontally scaling microservice, I don't care whether a single instance fails. That's expected, and my system handles this for me. So I don't want to alert on that. So we actually don't want this instance dimension in there at all. Because one instance might be failing all the time, while the other 999 are totally doing OK. And as a whole, our service is still perfectly doing its fulfilling its purpose. So what we can do, we can flip the condition in our aggregation. So instead of telling our system which dimensions to keep, we just tell it which dimensions to drop. That's generally safer, because if you're not entirely sure what dimensions they are, it's always easier to just say which one to drop explicitly and just keep everything else. And we can see this here. We are now dropping the instance and aggregate along everything else. And this brings us back the method label, which we dropped before, which wasn't good because you're obviously getting more GET requests than POST requests. And as before, the POST requests would have been totally masked by the high amount of GET requests. So this is actually what we want. This captures a high error rate. Just using our time series system by querying it and building a really sane query around it. And you can build similar things for like latency, etc. In general, they have to match on the labels. There's advanced label matching behavior, which you can do many to one and one to many and many to many mapping, but it's really advanced and you rarely need this. But yeah, you can do basically anything you want. So now let's look at one of these capacity and saturation alerts. We want to notify on the classic condition of a disk running full. So what we would typically do in a check or event-based system would be, if my disk is 90% full, that's bad, and please page me. The problem is, what if your disk was 89.9% full for 3 years, and now someone comes along and adds a 1 megabyte file? Now your disk is over 90%, and suddenly the world is not okay anymore. And that's not really true. I mean, you don't really care. Actually, you can run a disk at 95%, and it's still okay, as long as it doesn't fill up anymore. And similarly, if your disk is 10% full, but filling up rapidly at a rate of 1% per minute, if you wait until this threshold of 90% is hit, you have no time to react anymore. You have already lost. What we do instead, because we have time series, we don't only know the current state, we also know the state of the past. So we can look at the data of now and from 1 hour ago and just do a linear prediction based on that. So if the development of the last hour continues, where will I be in 4 hours? And if this means that we then get below zero, this means, okay, in 4 hours I will run out of disk, so better do something now. And this actually adapts to the case of having a low disk fill up rapidly, but also to the case of having a relatively full disk not filling up anymore. This actually then allows you to have plenty of time to react, but also don't have these really spammy alerts on disk usage, which usually cause you to just heavily underutilize your disk. And this actually covers your entire infrastructure, right? So you have one time series called node file system free, and your instance and every device on every instance is encoded in label dimensions. So this query actually queries a state for every single disk in your entire infrastructure. And this is one alert covering everything. And here we see a nice example of annotations being used. So we can just add a summary annotation, which just contains a more human readable form of the alert name. But we can actually also use templating. So we get these result elements, which have a label like instance, like device, like mount point. And we can now build a really nice text representation where we insert all these different label values. Then you get this nice page telling you exactly what's up. Now you have your time series system. You have all these alerting rules that generate multiple alerts each, possibly. And now what? Now we want something else. We want an alert manager which aggregates, deduplicates, and routes these alerts for you. And in Prometheus, this roughly looks like this. We have Prometheus, which collects data, and directly within the same instance, evaluates these alerts all the time. So you don't cross failure domains from collection to actually sending alerts, which is really good. And then you can just replicate Prometheus setups to then have HA properties. And the Prometheus instances then push out these alerts to the alert manager. And the alert manager is a component inside of the infrastructure which is replicated and basically replicates its own state via a gossip protocol and then cares about redirecting these alerts to different integrations like PagerDuty, Slack, Opsgenie, or anything custom you want. So what does alert manager actually do? Well, we have these alerting rules, and it doesn't really matter where they're coming from, whether it's Prometheus or something else. Just alert manager is completely agnostic to Prometheus. It just gets these key value pairs of alerts flown in. But in general, yeah, you have these generators of alerts, and they're just falling out there. And that's what you have. That's where most systems end, right? At 4:11 a.m., you get one page telling you high latency for service X in zone EU West for this pass, for this method. Then 3 seconds later, you get the next alert telling you the same thing. And this goes on. And you're standing there and like acting pages for 10 minutes before you can actually get to work. Not really good. What we instead want is the alert manager, which is basically ingests all these alerts from the Prometheus servers and then aggregates them together. And do deduplicate them, of course. And you can aggregate them along certain label dimensions, right? You can say, my alert has a label zone for the data center and a label service, indicating the service it's about. And then you can just aggregate them into buckets that actually match the on-call routine you have. So you have people on call for service X, for data center Y. And then you can just, okay, let's throw all these alerts in one bucket and set on one notification, which then can look like this. It's telling you you have 15 alerts for service X in zone EU West, and 3 of them are on high latency, 10 of them are on high error rate, and 2 of them are on the cache server being slow. And that's the really comprehensive thing you want, right? You don't care about 15 alerts coming away, you care about the digest of what is wrong in my system that I'm responsible for. And then these notifications are just routed to PagerDuty, chat, you can even file Jira tickets, right? If you have something that can wait until tomorrow, you can just forward them and have a Jira ticket being created so that the next person can then, during working hours, take care of the problem. And the load manager actually does something more for you, right? You have silencing, so you can also silence based on labels. Let's say you take a service into maintenance, and you expect alerts to happen, but you're already on it and don't want to disturb anyone else. You just say, okay, for the next 2 hours, silence every incoming alert that has a label service equals X, because I'm currently maintaining this service. There's also some advanced stuff going on. You can have inhibition. And inhibition is a concept. If you have one alert firing, then don't alert me on certain other alerts. For example, you have an alert telling you that your data center is on fire, and this will probably indicate that a lot of services in the data center are not functioning properly. So many people will be paged, but they all cannot do anything. So it's probably a good idea to just say, okay, it's on fire. Someone will care about it, but anything running inside of it is expected to fail, and don't send all these pages out. That's, of course, the extreme example, but it's generally a convenient way how you can avoid like cross-team disruption in your alerting pattern. Yeah, getting back to anomaly detection, because we still like that. Okay, maybe we can actually do it. Can we implement something practical and sane that is not some magical thing, but a clearly defined alert on a certain anomaly? And let's take one example. We have traffic, and we want to check whether our traffic is within some bounds with respect to the same traffic last week. So, like, are we 20% below or below or above the same traffic for the same service last week? So we can take our request total metric again and aggregate it for our entire service, so that we now have a representation of how many requests per second were there for the entire service, ignoring all the other labels. And then we can throw this into a holdWinters function. That's just one of these query functions Prometheus has, and it does exponential smoothing. So it turns this blue spiky curve here into this really smooth baseline, which gives you a good representation of how your traffic actually behaved over the day. And yeah, we store the first one respectively in the new job request rate 5 minute metric, and the second one in the job request holdWinters rate 1 hour metric. And we can then use these respectively in new expressions. And then we can define an alert on abnormal traffic. So we take our current request rate and compare it to the same smoothened request rate from 1 week ago. And if the difference is more than 20%, we say, okay, that's probably bad. It's probably not as we intended. That's abnormal to us. So all the points falling in the blue line here are fine, and all the red points here are, that are above or below it are now an alert. So this is practical anomaly detection. We specify the data set that we're talking about. We specify the baseline, like what's normal, and we specify very clearly what is the anomaly. So there's no magic involved. It's just pure expressive definition of anomaly. And another example, which is, well, it's just showing what the Prometheus query language can do and how it can get really complicated. You don't have to understand it all. Let's say we want to alert on one instance in our microservice having a higher average latency than all the other ones. So one instance is behaving abnormal. We can do this. So we have a metric on instance latency seconds, average over 5 minutes. And now we take the average of all instances and calculate the 2-time standard deviation, and then verify whether a single instance is greater than this combined standard, greater than the combined average plus 2 standard deviations of it. Seems interesting, and it's quite powerful, but then you realize, okay, actually every single instance is almost exactly the same in terms of latency. So now your standard deviation gets super small, which means that even the slightest offset in latency for a single instance now triggers an alert. It's not really what you wanted, so we have to somehow handle this. And we can do so, because Prometheus has a really powerful query language, so we extend this by another condition directly embedded in the query. We wrap everything we had before, and now say, also, only do this if the latency is actually 20% higher than the mean latency of all instances. So we take the standard deviation as well as an absolute minimum of 20%. And then you realize that you have some services laying around that are not really getting traffic, and they always have code caches, and they're therefore super slow, which doesn't matter because they are not in production because they don't get any traffic. Okay, maybe add a condition. So we add another condition, which has do all of the above, but only if this particular service across all instances is getting more than one request per second. So as you can see, the query language is really powerful and allows you to do all this stuff. But you also see that even if you clearly specify the baseline and the abnormally, you run into edge cases all the time, and you have to fix them and add conditions and conditions and conditions. And it gets really complicated really fast. And you're usually better off if you just take the symptoms, page on what's actually wrong, and don't try to be clever about what might be abnormal. Self-healing. Generally not recommended. It's really hard to get right, just as anomaly detection, because in the end, you're triggering automated actions, which might cause all sorts of interesting feedback loops. Many people have tried it. Not many have succeeded. But you can do it, right? You can have Prometheus scrape metrics from anywhere, define alerting conditions on it, send these alerts to Alert Manager, and the Alert Manager can just notify a custom application that you built. And this application can now inspect, okay, the alert is about this and that, and based on this, I will now take action Y in my infrastructure. So it's totally possible. I wouldn't recommend it, but you can do everything. So conclusion, for time series-based alerting, use symptom-based pages to define what your system should be behaving like, and use cause-based warnings to then assist people in actually investigating these pages and finding the cause. Try to design your alerts adaptive to change so that you don't have to readjust them constantly, and preserve as many dimensions as you can to don't lose any detail, but aggregate away the dimensions that you are fault-tolerant along. And for anything capacity and saturation-based, linear prediction is your friend. It works for almost anything, whether it is taking care that your disks are not running full, or that you don't run out of file descriptors, or that you have enough total RAM left in your entire data center so that you know when you have to add new machines. Any sort of this is really well handled by linear prediction over time series data. And yeah, you can do these advanced alerting things and anomaly detection. It's usually not necessary, but yeah, in some cases, it can really be interesting. It shouldn't stop at generating alerts. You need another component that's actually capable of aggregating these alerts into something that actually then reaches humans, right? Your alerting system should generate more alerts than a human can handle, and your alert management system should then compose these into something humans can digest. Yeah, that was it. Thank you. And now time for questions.
Anyone?
Hi. You were focusing, especially in the early part of the talk, on monitoring what matters to users, what hurts the users, and generating alerts based on that. Isn't that kind of leaving things a bit late? If the users have noticed something, or if the alert based on what hurts the users triggers, shouldn't you have tried to notice something about the performance of the systems first, before it gets that far?
That's when you hit the point of doing cause-based alerting, right? And in general, it's just incredibly hard to get right because there's so many causes for every potential symptom. It can be really hard to catch, and not every potential cause actually results in a problem. So it all depends on what your system is, right? If you have some, I don't know, high-frequency trading platform, yeah, you probably want to detect that early. But if you have a microservice serving some sort of web service to users, well, then the latency is slow. That's probably okay, and then you can. You probably have some other system in place in front that then fails over to another data center, et cetera. It's just the way more reliable way to alert based on symptoms. And you're, in general case, you're probably better off having your users have occasional problems than having engineers being totally worn out every night because they get 10 pages that cannot really do anything about.
One more?
You showed one example, and I understood that you bundle alerts affecting a certain region to notify the on-duty engineer responsible for this. What if the engineer only solves one of the issues and leaves the others untouched? Will there be re-notification, or how do you see there's still work to do?
Yeah. So initially, we aggregate all these alerts together, but of course, then you have a group of alerts, and there might be new alerts coming to this group, and some are resolved, and we just have a periodic updating logic that then A, resends you a page if you like leave it completely unsolved, or in the other case, just updates the current state. So it will be updated.
Mm-hmm. And you see it in a web page, or do you get SMS? Or
it depends on integration, right? You can have, for example, integrated to Slack, so that just have a chat message. You can have PagerDuty, and all these different integrations have sort of slightly different semantics on how they update, and it really depends a bit. But we are working with quite a few of them to basically improve this to fit the alert manager use case really well.
Thank you.
Could you tell us something on the performance impact of such alerts if I have many of them?
So of course we built our entire system to deal with a general load, right? Prometheus is built to be capable to handle millions of time series per node and billions of samples. Similarly, Alert Manager is designed to basically handle the same stream of incoming alerts. So with the current design concept, we haven't done like completely edge benchmarking, but for example, we have Cloudflare using it. And you can probably easily have 10,000 and more alerts per second without that being a problem at all.
Good.
Is there a way to maintain the time series database? We started with the Prometheus project, and now we have some wrong matrix inside, and we want to clean up without removing all the data.
You can clean up data. There's an API endpoint to delete like subsets of metrics. You cannot modify past data because it's a monitoring system, and there's like really no point in changing how full my disk was last week. You can delete but not modify.
Good. Thank you very much. Very cool project.